And I have to do the same thing. I have to abandon all those vulnerabilities and just make more of myself in that moment. I have to believe in myself the way that I am asking other people to believe in themselves. I lived right outside of Detroit. My parents emigrated from Greece. They landed, you know, right outside of Detroit, which is an amazing music city, so I was so blessed to land there. My stepdad actually was really, really into music. He owned over 10,000 records, and he would stay up late at night making mixtapes. And we were very close, and I really, really bonded with music with him. And, you know, so in the morning I would, you know, I could wake up and hear Greek music or Arabic music, and then, you know, there would be a movie soundtrack I was listening to, or Pink Floyd. So it was just such a wide range of music that I listened to constantly. At that point, I had no idea that I was a bit of a musician myself. I just knew I had the ear for it and the passion for it. And I loved so many of the different sounds. I mean, there wasn't really one I gravitated toward. I liked them all. My first music memory, it was, funny enough, it was a Fleetwood Mac song. And again, I was 7 or 8 years old, and I just remember hearing the intro to it, and it just captured me. And I had to just play it over and over again. And I just knew there was something there. It just, something in me just resonated with music. I was a shy kid. I was very quiet, and yeah, Michael Jackson pretty much changed that. I became like a little dance machine. All I wanted to do was dance. Dancing really broke me out of my shell. Of course, Madonna, of course, Prince, and later on, you know, George Michael, but the icons of the 80s and 90s really, really changed things for me. You had this amazing era of in the 80s of music videos. They were like mini movies, you know, so the visual and the sound were always connected. And even though, you know, later on I gave up the idea of becoming a professional dancer, I mean, the choreography still stays in your mind, you know. So when I hear a song, especially a dance song, I think about a great choreography and how I would dance to it. Those mega icons, you know, Prince, Michael Jackson, George Michael, Madonna, I mean, they were, their visuals and their music, they were one. They weren't separate, and they were also fashion icons. So it all just fused together in this beautiful way that I had no idea was influencing me on multiple levels. So by the time I get to a middle school and I pick up my first Harper's Bazaar and Vogue, I gravitated toward the world of fantasy, of fashion. And so that's how I started in photography, is mimicking fashion photography. In high school, I continued dancing. I was in a dance troupe, and I took photography courses. And it was there that I felt like I found what I wanted to do, what I wanted to be. Just being in the dark room and seeing, you know, the images come up in the chemical bath, it was like alchemy, and it was magical. I took portraits of family and friends, but it was in the style of fashion photography. It was everything that I was influenced by. All the teachers in high school, they were really, they saw, you know, something in me, and they really pushed me to pursue photography. And I also did get some awards early on, 10th, 11th grade, senior year, in the photography contests and things like that. So that was encouraging. You know, by the time I'd had to decide, you know, what I was really gonna do when I went off to college, I said, you know what, I'm gonna do this, because I just feel like it will just make me happy in life if I pursue my passion. Style and fashion has been an expression for me personally. It's how I express myself. It's how I communicate to the world and how I feel confident it actually makes me feel a little bit better about the world. Yeah, portraiture itself, I mean, it's just incredibly powerful. And fashion helps to tell that story as well. So these are my Afropunk series. I documented the festival between 2015 and 2017. And I'd never heard of the festival. I'd never been to a music festival before, surprisingly. And I went and wow, I was just blown away by the creativity. People are out in full force, just showing up as their best selves and down to the fingernail. They are Afropunk. They're their own unique interpretation. They're there to be photographed. They want to be photographed. It's a photographer's dream. And I think people really resonate with these portraits because of that. They see this originality, this courage to just step out of, you know, all these different boxes, right? Gender fluid, all kinds of boxes. So I think people really respond to that, and they love, obviously, the expression and the fashion. The music is obviously an amazing part of the festival as well. So these are portraits of some of the most inspirational people I found there. And it was just absolutely one of the most awesome experiences I've had photographing people anywhere. Most recently, I have taken a little bit of a departure from, you know, stylized portraiture to more of a photojournalistic lens. Throughout the pandemic, I, you know, was a bit lost, especially in the beginning, on, you know, how I'm going to continue my work as an artist. And, you know, I'm in a community of artists and entrepreneurs myself, and I started to think, what was, you know, everyone else doing? How are they coping? How are they surviving? So I just started calling my friends who I knew were in the same boat, and I asked them, I said, you know, would you mind if I photograph you in front of your business, your closed business? Everybody said yes, and I knew that the portrait was not going to just tell the story in and of itself. I knew I had to capture their words. So I recorded voice interviews of them, and I knew that just putting that text next to that portrait would speak volumes, so you can understand what each of these people were going through. It just wasn't really a thought. It was something I just knew I had to do and tell the story of my community. You know, being in front of a camera for 99.5% of people is pretty terrifying. And so when they come to me, it's like they really, you know, they're very anxious. And I just tell them, you know what, we have to create, you know, the way we have to create is to just abandon all your preconceived notions. We start with that vision, that dream you have of yourself. Abandon everything else, your fear, be vulnerable, help me create with you, which is a huge honor. And I know it's because, you know, they trust me to do that, and I can help them make that vision come to life. In a way, I mean, it's definitely very therapeutic, because once they see that image of themselves, they're definitely changed. They say, I didn't even think I can look like that. I could be that. I could feel that. So it's the process of creating that image is very transformative. I think that can't be minimized at all, because it's a huge thing for someone to come in and start from scratch and want to kind of recreate themselves and then show themselves as who they want to be. It's very courageous. This portrait of Angel is very special. It's another example of abandoning the confines of who people tell you should be, and abandoning those vulnerabilities to then create who you want to be. This resonates with a lot of people, and it's also very special to me because of the trust and the feelings that were exchanged that day. Because when they saw the image, they were just blown away. Is that me? This is who I want to be. I'm proud of this portrait in many ways, but especially because it reminds me of the origin of why I even picked up the camera, which is the great late fashion photographer Herb Ritts.
Depth isn't something that I don't even know if you choose. It basically just presents itself. It's instantaneous. You connect. And it's really in the eyes. If it's not in the eyes, it's nowhere. And I know when I see the image, if that person is connecting with the camera. So it's in the eyes, it's in the expression. The fashion is, yes, part of it, it's just the outer layer, but it is what the expression is communicating that is the most important.
This is a friend of mine who got diagnosed with a rare form of cancer. As I saw her metamorphosis, you know, her changing, there was this one photo she posted online and she obviously lost all of her hair, and she's already beautiful, but she just looked like a mannequin. And I said, let me take some portraits of you. And you know, she's a stylist herself, and we've worked together on many shoots, so she trusted me. You know, people did mention to me after they've seen them, we've never seen anyone going through treatment looking glamorous. You know, she doesn't look sick. She just looks like a real badass, you know? And I know that it really made her feel better just about everything she was going through to have these portraits of her, which I think are timeless. Because she's just, she's handling the moment, she's handling this difficult situation, and she is not letting it get her down. She's just still being her best self. Thankfully, she's alive and well today, so we have these to look back on, and these are very special, very special to me. Sometimes I didn't realize even what I was doing, which was empowering people. So through empowering them, it's also empowering myself. Comparing it to, you know, when I perform with my music, I actually have to undergo the same challenge. How I even got into DJing in the first place was photographing more and more DJs. And they knew I was a collector of this chill out sound, this down tempo sound that came out in the early 2000s. And they said, well, you're so passionate about that sound, you know, you should play live. And I was like, no, I'm not gonna do that. I just absolutely did not want to be in front of people performing. I don't see myself as a performer, but I was forced to basically play six songs for a friend. You know, it was like riding a roller coaster. It was like I was playing over a loudspeaker and people were responding. I was looking around the room and, you know, I changed the environment of the room. I found myself in the Ritz-Carlton for a photography job, and I left being the resident DJ. A record player was given to me, and so I said, oh, well, let me start buying some vinyl. I was at a Greek festival, and there was a little area where it said, like, Yaya's attic, and you had all kinds of random things. So I go in, and I see all these old Greek records. So one of the first songs I played on it's called Evening Stroll. And just the beginning of it is just this, like, this dark, this key of this piano. And it was like the opening of a movie. Like, I could see the visuals of the opening of a scene in a movie. And I just absolutely loved the song. And I thought, I really want to translate this to the dance floor. And that is how the Vespers EP came to be. And that was my first producing, you know, that was my first foray into producing music. And it was released last June, and it ended up number 2 on the Deep House Beatport chart and number 4 on the electronic chart. So It was really, really a big surprise, and just hearing that very inspirational, you know, piece of music and then translating it, it was like, okay, I want to do this again, which led me to the second one. Go Get It was inspired again by the visuals, by a scene in a movie where the main character looks at his son and he says, "Don't ever let anyone tell you you can't do something, not even me." And I thought, what if I take that? What if I put that in a dance song, you know? So I contacted another amazing producer, a local from Baltimore, and I said, "I really want you to help me bring this message to the dance floor. You know, if you want something, go get it. Don't ever let anyone tell you what you can and can't do."
Show me.